What is hope? Modern culture tells us it is a maybe, a kind of unsure optimism. But in scripture, hope is an indication of certainty. Hope means a strong and confident expectation. The Israelites were hoping for a savior, their Messiah. God had promised a Messiah, and they believed it. They didn't know when or who, but they were waiting. Zechariah was a Levite in the nation of Israel. He worked in the temple and was a God-fearing man. He and his wife Elizabeth were childless in a culture where children were a sign of God's blessing. Zechariah had prayed and prayed to God, asking for a child, but God had not sent one. As Zechariah stood in the Holy of Holies that day, preparing to offer the sacrifices for the people, an angel appeared to him with a message from God.
Fear not, Zacharias. Your prayers have been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son. You are to name him John. He will be a joy and a delight to you, and many will rejoice because of his birth, for he will be great in the sight of the Lord his God. He is never to take wine or fermented drink, and he will be filled with the Holy Spirit even from birth. Many of the people of Israel will he bring back to the Lord their God, and he will go before the Lord to make ready a people.
But when Zechariah heard Gabriel's words, his first reaction was not hope. It was doubt. He asked the angel, "But how can this be? I am an old man." The angel responded,
"I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God, and I have been sent to speak to you and to tell you this is good news."
Elizabeth did become pregnant, and Zechariah found himself wholeheartedly living in hope, in confident expectation that God would give him a son and that the long-awaited Messiah was soon to follow. Today, we too can live with Zechariah's hope. We can live with the certainty and the confident expectation that Christ not only came to this world as a baby so long ago, but he will return, and everything that God has promised will come true. What hope!
What hope indeed. As we celebrate Advent, as we look towards celebrating Christ's birth, there is so much reason for hope. And as you look in the front of your bulletins, today we're reading, or we'll be learning about dispelling anxiety from Philippians 4:6-9. And as I thought about that, dispelling anxiety, I was like, what is the opposite of anxiety? And I think what I came up with was peace. And so as we sing today, as we worship together through song, I want you to think about the peace that we can have through Christ. And I have John 14:27 just in front of me here, where Christ said to the disciples, "I am leaving you with a gift, peace of mind and heart. And the peace I give is a gift the world cannot give. So don't be troubled or afraid." Let us worship the Lord our God together. I invite you to stand as we sing.
Rejoice, the Lord is King, your Lord and King adore. Rejoice, give thanks and sing and triumph evermore. Lift up your heart, lift up your voice, rejoice again, I say, rejoice. The Lord, the Savior, reigns, the God of truth and love. When he had purged our stains, he took his seat above. Lift up your heart, lift Lift up your voice, rejoice again, I say, rejoice. His kingdom cannot fail, he rules o'er earth and hell. The keys of death and hell are to us, Jesus, give. Lift up your heart, lift up your voice, rejoice again, I say, rejoice. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King, peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. Joyful all ye nations rise, join the triumph of the skies, with angelic hosts proclaim, Christ is born in Bethlehem. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Christ by highest heaven adored, Christ the everlasting Lord, late in time behold him come, offspring of the Virgin's womb, veiled in flesh the God and sea, hailed incarnate deity, pleased as man with men to dwell, Jesus on Emmanuel. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Hail, the headborn Prince of Peace, hail, the Son of Righteousness, light and life to all he brings, risen with healing in his wings. Mild he lives his glory by, born that man no more may die, born to raise the sons of earth, born to give them second birth. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the new.
Amen. Please be seated.
What, you don't think it's sincere?
Good morning, everyone. Welcome here. Special welcome to any visitors amongst us. It's great to have you here this first Sunday of Advent season. I think this was quite a way to kick off this season. With the Advent reading, and then the group up here. Thank you so much, guys, and Iris and ladies. A couple announcements this morning. Our offering table, because of decorations, has moved, so it is now on the outside of the back sanctuary wall. So if you're looking for the basket, that's where it is. The Joy to the World little devotional books are on the back table by the stairwell, but also some are on the offering table now as well, so be sure to grab one of those for yourself and for a friend. Reverse Advent calendar has been started, and donations are being collected and are also along the back wall, and the last day for collecting is December 21st, so if you are participating in that, please have everything here at the church by that day. And women's book study is Mondays 10:30 to 12 p.m. So if you're able to participate in that, that is your timeline. And take note of the Christmas service schedule there. And just be aware of what days and what time that is happening. So we can go to prayer. Thank you, Lord, for this wonderful day, this wonderful season that we celebrate the birth of your son, Jesus. The gift of him is indescribable for us, and we just appreciate it so much, Lord, and the hope and life it gives us. We just thank you so much. And we pray, Lord, that you just be with us through this service, through the worship and the leading and the scripture that Brian will give us. Pray that you just make us ready for each and every part of it, and help us to see and be leading examples of what this season is to others in our community. And I just pray that you can be with us in doing that, and the offering as well, that you be with it and put it where it needs to go. And I just thank you for this day. Thank you for our church family. And I pray that your love and your hand is with us each and every day, and that we see it, we feel it, and we can share that with others and show them your love. In your name we pray. Children ages 4 to grade 3 are now dismissed for classes downstairs.
And I invite you to stand with us as we continue singing together this morning.
All the world awaits the promise of his birth. Open up the gates, heaven come to earth. A host of angels sing, our Savior here to dwell. The King of every king, our Emmanuel.
Let's sing that again.
Hosanna to our Hosanna, 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 in the highest, Hosanna, in the highest, Hosanna, in the highest, Hosanna to our God. I approach the throne of glory. Nothing in my hands I bring, but the promise of acceptance from a good and gracious King. I will give to you my burden as you give to me your strength. Come and fill me with your spirit as I sing to you this praise. You deserve the greater glory. That you would see as your child and as your friend, safe, secure in you forever. I pour out my praise again. You deserve the greater glory. The King in need of nothing, empty-handed I rejoice. You deserve the greater glory. Overcome with joy I sing. By your love I am accepted. You're a good and gracious King. Holy, holy, deserve the greater glory. Overcome, I lift my voice to the King in need of nothing. Empty-handed, I rejoice. You deserve the greater glory. Overcome with joy, I sing. By your love, I am accepted. You're a good and gracious King. You're a good and gracious King. You're a good and gracious King.
Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Please be seated.
I'm really excited about this scripture this morning, Philippians 4, verses 1 to 9. Therefore, my beloved brothers and sisters, whom I long to see, my joy and crown, stand firm in the Lord in this way, my beloved. I urge Judea and I urge Syntyche to live in harmony in the Lord. Indeed, true companion, I ask you also, help these women who have shared my struggle in the cause of the gospel, together with Clement, as well as the rest of my fellow workers, whose names are in the book of life. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again I say, rejoice. Let your gentle spirit be known to all people. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and pleading with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all comprehension, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence and if anything worthy of praise, think about these things. As for the things you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, practice these things, and the God of peace will be with you.
Thank you very much, Linda. Yeah, let me give you a little plug again for the Christmas season that's coming up. We are doing Joy to the World. Joy, that's the personal experience. To the world, that's mission, isn't it? Joy is our personal joy to the world. So I've been already kind of doing this. And let me just give you a heads up. If you're planning to underline things in this, like I do, I always love to take down notes. It doesn't do very good because it means you can't read the next page. So there's the heads up for you. This is brilliant, by the way. So I hope you're planning to do this as a family. Make sure you do it from December 1st onwards. They're very, very short readings, but they're very powerful. So, and I'm going to be trying my best to kind of gathering all the messages around that booklet, so we'll kind of get it from both sides. Yeah, listen, Christmas Day we're having a service, and I know already you've said, not a chance, I'm not coming. We're only getting up, we're only going to have breakfast at that time, do you know what I mean? Yeah, I want to make sure that we keep saying we want Christ to be the center of Christmas. Here's the best way to do it, isn't it? You know, when I grew up in Ireland, the first thing we had was from 7 a.m. in the morning to about 10:30, we had always had a Christmas fry-up. which meant that the house was filled with smoke. You couldn't see out for want of the... It was awesome. So when I think of it, I see the beams of light coming in the window, cutting across when the whole house is full of, the smoke from a fry-up. Now, I know you're probably... I want you to do that a little bit earlier, if that's what you do. So it's a 45-minute service. That's the best way, isn't it, to have Christ as really central to the day and puts everything else in its place. Okay, I'm not going to try and guilt you anymore about that. I know already you're feeling it and you've kind of decided, I'll come then. we're just going to bow, and there's a couple of things I just want to bring before the Lord in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we're just so blessed to be blessed by you, O God, and through the various avenues of grace that you give us. Your word, having your people lead us in worshiping your name, the different gifts that you give the church, the encouragement we are to each other, the love that we share, the blessing of our fellowship, the peace that we share together, the depth and the authentic relationships that we have in you, Lord. We're so thankful. We know that the world is in a mess. We know that everything around us is not getting better, even though there's spin everywhere on every conceivable thing. We know that it's in meltdown. But whereas what you're doing in us, we are being transformed from glory to glory. Not because of who we are or something innate to us, but you are in us, transforming us into your image, Jesus, and we're so blessed by it. We want to lift up to you those among us, for one reason or another, can't be here with us this morning, and we want to lift them up. We ask your blessing. We ask that you would bring to them a sense of your presence, bring to them an awareness of your goodness, and your sovereignty and the love that you have for each one. So I pray for sickness, Father, you would raise them up. You would encourage, heal, Father, and refocus every heart upon you. Lord Jesus, you are worthy of everything in our lives. You're worthy of every conceivable thing that we can think about. You are greater. You deserve the greater glory. So I pray, Father, for those among us this morning who need to be encouraged. I pray for us as a church, we would get new and extra awareness of not just those who are here, but those who are not. So we'll reach out and bless and encourage and be aware of each other and lift each other up before you. We want to just lift up again, as you've called us to do, to bring before you the leaders of this country, Lord. We want to lift up both local and federal. We bring them, Lord, to you for in these days of initial awareness for us as a church that things are fluid and things can change rapidly. But not for us, for our hearts are steadfast in you, O God, no matter what circumstance, whether it's suffering or peace, Lord, we are fully aware that you are the Lord of every circumstance. We want to lift up again to you all of those who are serving us in this community. We want to know, Father, what it means for us to seek the welfare of this city. Lord, we want to do that because we know that it is a display of your grace on us to be givers and not just receivers. We want to be aware of those around us who don't know you, Lord. We want to bring Jesus into each one of these circumstances. We lift up each family to you that may have, in some periods, have the name of following, but need you to bring us by your Spirit closer together as families, to build in the truth of your word. As these days grow dark, give us a new awareness that our responsibilities are as important as ever. Thank you again, O God, for the ministries and the service that goes on in this church, your church. And I pray, Father, you wouldn't just increase it, you'd multiply it, Lord. In what it means to have received everything, you would call us to be givers and blessers and benevolent people as we seek to be servants in this community. So give us a deepening sense of what that means for us to have been blessed by so much so we can give. Be with me as I bring this word to your church this morning. Help us together passionately desire not just that it enter our hearts and minds, but it would become a part of what it means for our faith to trust you in deeper ways. So we commit ourselves to that now in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. So this was kind of our little mini-series, wasn't it? Like the fourth one of our little mini-series within the big series. And Philippians 4, 1-9 is a kind of a blueprint for us to be able to stand firm together. See, I know what goes on. You're thinking, that sounds great, but that is not essential for us right now. Because we're under no persecution. We don't have to be really thinking about that. There might be a bit of what we used to call handbags at 10 paces. Has anybody any idea what that means? Handbags at 10 paces. You remember what they used to do at 10 paces? You know, you got your guns, you back to back, and you took 10 paces and you shot. Well, for us, we're not using guns. We just use handbags. Do you know what I mean? Just to, not to kill each other, but just to annoy each other. Anyway, that's lost on you. But what does it mean for us to stand united together and standing firm together? That's verse 1 in chapter 4. And we said, number one, it was living in harmony in the Lord. You can't just manufacture this by bath bubbles. It really has to come from the grace of God revealed in the cross of Jesus, applied by the Spirit of God. That's reconciliation. We talked about, secondly, living in joy in the Lord. Above all people, we've got to be. If we're not, we've missed something. The happiest people on the planet, if we haven't gotten an understanding of the cross, and if we don't receive that joy, it means we've probably misunderstood the cross, who for the joy set before him endured it for our sake. So joy, it's love, joy, peace, isn't it? It's even the fruits of the Spirit. Thirdly, last week we talked about living in gentleness, and we said that word gentleness is a very unusual one. It's not bandanas and, you know, kind of 1970s Volkswagen music. Do you know what I mean? It's not that. It's something much more deeper, isn't it? It's about consideration and thoughtfulness and care, but gentleness. So the last of this kind of little series before we go into our Christmas series, focus on how to dispel anxiety. Let's pray again, okay? Just one more. Just a moment before the Lord. Father, I don't know who's in this room who are filled with fears and anxieties. I don't know who's being captured by a fear that no one else knows about. But I am praying in your name that your Holy Spirit would touch each one of us this morning with the truth of this word in Jesus' name. Amen. There's a rich man who commissioned three painters to paint him a picture that for them would capture peace. First painted a beautiful picture of mountain grandeur. Our eyes then to be lifted up, you know, from the cares of the mundane problems of life. The second painter painted a picture of the beauty of the ocean. The third painted a picture of a waterfall, a raging river falling hundreds of feet to the crashing rocks below. The rich man asked, "How is this peaceful? For I've stood before waterfalls, and I can tell you that it is anything but peaceful. Sound is deafening. Turbulence of crashing water actually made me more anxious, not less." The artist replied, "Look closer. I painted the waterfall from the side. Look underneath the fall. Look behind the water, and you'll see a cleft in a rock. What do you see now?" He replied, "I see a small bird, unruffled and settled in the cleft." "That's it," he replied. It's in the midst of the noisy turbulence, the bird find a place of rest. That's real peace. The ability to be quiet, not in the absence, but in the midst of chaos. We live in an anxious age. Since therapy, since 1960, we're even more anxious. We're so focused on our feelings. But just living in an anxious world breeds anxiety, doesn't it? Escape, then, seems to be the preferred method of dealing with worry. Alcohol, drugs, computer games, sexual addictions, materialisms are all forms of escapism to deliver us from the feelings of vulnerability and fear and doubt. But they're a bottomless pit, unfortunately, and they're destructive to your faith. For peace is not found in escapism or substitutes or counterfeits or distractions, since the source of peace must be greater than the weight of the concern for us to trust it. Has to be. And neither alcohol, drugs, sex, or Netflix is able to help us in the midst of the storm. They will, in fact, create more anxiety in the long run. They can't be trusted. For if all worry is the toxic waste of unbelief, all of these things plunge us into what some have called practical atheism. For us, as Max Anders says, tomorrow's anxieties are built on the results of today's thoughts. It's a good statement. Everyone in this room has myriads of worries and concerns, natural, rational, and irrational ones too. And at different stages of life, we're anxious over kids, we're anxious over our security, over our future. We worry about sickness, pain, and death. Many fear loneliness, rejection, or failure. We'll be sleepless, worrying about the unknown, worrying about gossip and slander, worrying why people are not talking about us. The list is absolutely endless. And each new circumstance carries its own measure. We may be filled with doubt about God and one another. But we won't reject them. We'll just ignore them and sideline them. That's far more palatable. And anyone telling you that there is one silver bullet to dispel fear is not living in the real world. Nor will just one thing banish rising levels of panic. Have you ever been there? Rising levels of despair. Now, we know that because many of us have tried them. We also know it because God's word won't allow us to think like that. See, in fact, if we say that prayer on its own gets rid of anxiety, we're in danger of falling for a fallacy of what they call hyper-spirituality. Back in the 17th and 18th century, there was a movement in the church called Pietism, which rightly emphasized the Christian's experience that refocuses on your personal faith in Christ and your devotion to Him. It was an overreaction to an overemphasized theological correctness, all the theological eggheads. So it was a reaction to that. But like all good pendulum swings, that also went too far in a tendency against thinking. And we're prone to do that. We do that today. We all know people. We may be the very people ourselves who pray and worship as a dominant feature of your life. And I know different maybe from those who read their Bibles every day as a daily exercise, or absolutely do none of them, but who are just as jittery as a squirrel, just as susceptible to fear and anger, just as eligible for all the usual side effects as anyone. When the world won't get its act together and do what they want, and when they want it done. So it's in this reality of our lives today that Paul wants to address us in this passage. How do we dispel with unhealthy anxiety? How do we dismiss overwhelming worries? How do you discharge debilitating fears and apprehensions? Well, I want you to imagine a pyramid that has only got three huge big blocks. The first is by far the largest, and upon which the other two are built. So that's what you have in verse 6 and 7 of this passage. This is about prayer, isn't it? Say. Whereas what he says is, be anxious. He doesn't say don't be anxious. Be anxious, but for absolutely nothing. Just a different way of saying it, isn't it? Our modern lives demand and even command us to be anxious. It wasn't all that long ago that we all knew, whatever you knew, was all local. Which of themselves were enough. Life was tough, life was harsh, even brutal, and for many it was short, not that long ago. People hardly knew what was going on in the next town or the next city, never mind the next country or the next continent. Rapidly, our recent generations have the printed press, have the telephone. We quickly threw satellites into space like throwing sand in the air. We've got emails, we've got Facebook, we've got news coverage, video details are nearly almost instantaneous. It's no wonder we've been called a global village. I can sit through a single newscast and hear about local murders, potential economic downturns, job losses, and at the same time I'll hear about famines and wars, plus details of refugees, plane crashes, genocides. And then on top of all of those things that we're bombarded with, I wake up to cars that won't start, babies that won't stop crying, workmates that drive you nuts, teenagers that defy and demand everything. So it seems. It's no wonder, so many say, you have no idea what I lived through. You don't know what I'm going through. It's an impossibility. It's unrealistic. It's just not doable. Be anxious for nothing? Well, that's applicable for someone else. Has to be, but not for me. But the simple thing I want to say to us this morning, according to this verse, it's clear, it's unequivocal, and it's explicit truth. Yes, it can. You can be anxious for nothing. The passage tells you not to be anxious, but it also tells you how. It tells you how. Let your requests be made known to God in everything. Let your requests be known. Doesn't God already know? Well, yes, of course he does. When he asks for Adam in the garden, where are you? Do you not think God knows already? He knows already what's going on in your heart. But what has he said? Make it known. Yeah, in everything, by prayer and supplication and thanksgiving. I like the message. It says, don't fret, don't worry. Instead of worrying, pray. Let petitions and praises shape your worries into prayers. Isn't that good? Isn't that? I like the way that's put. Let petitions and praises shape your worries into prayers, letting God know them. Let God know your concerns. So I'm going to ask you to do this right now, mentally or scribally. Is that even a word? I'm not even sure. We'll look that up afterwards. The first two things that come to your mind that you're anxious about right now, what are the first two things? Maybe I'm one of them, but let's forego that. The first two things that you're worried, write them down in your bulletin. And let me ask you this simple, direct question. Have you prayed? Have I prayed? Have you taken the time to pray? When was the last time, as D.A. Carson has written, that you prayed explicitly and at length over the things that worry you, that trouble you, or plague you? Did you take them out and did you recount them to God? One by one, laying your burdens on Him. Did you do it? Have I? Why do we love worrying so much? See, time and time alone and quiet before God is what we need. Psalm 91. He who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will abide in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say to the Lord, you're my refuge. You're my fortress, my God in whom I trust. Did you get what's going on in that verse? He dwells in the shelter. He's not just passing through. 1 Peter 5:7. Casting all your anxiety on Him because He cares for you. But do I really believe that? Do I? When I cast, this word says He catches. When I cast, He really cares. That's explicitly what Peter is saying. We're revitalizing a certain knowledge that the one who dwells with us, the one whom we have cast our concerns upon us, He's given us an absolute assurance of His sovereignty and His wise goodness. He's not fidgeting about hoping that you're, you know, wondering, is your particular concern going to overwhelm him and catch him out? He's not squinting His eyes and saying, oh my goodness, please don't ask me that. Donald Carson says this, good sentence. He says, I've yet to meet a chronic worrier who enjoyed an excellent prayer life. But all the while, He never demands that we enter into some kind of Willy Wonka or chocolate factory land until it all goes away. Do you know what I mean? God's not asking us to do that. We live with all the concerns and worries of humanity, and we're commanded not to try and escape them. In fact, we're to come in the midst of all with thanksgiving. Hebrews 13:15. Through Him, then, through Christ, let us continually offer, what does it say? Offer up a sacrifice of praise. A sacrifice of praise. Isn't that interesting? Sacrifice of praise to God. That is, now He tells us, the fruit of lips that give thanks to His name. You see, when all is well, praise is easy. But when God allows all kinds of things that can naturally bring fear and anxiety, that's why it's called a sacrifice, you see. With requests and cares, we add thanks. How? Well, He says, it's because you're in Christ. We're reconciled by grace, He says. And the eternal blessings can't be compared to the sufferings. That's, we can bring them to Him. And then He says this, and the peace of God, which surpasses all comprehension, will guard your heart. Will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ. You kind of get the feeling He's trying to convince us of something. Don't you get that feeling? Notice that it doesn't say that God will take you out of it, but that He Himself will bring His supernatural grace. He will. He'll do this. To stand over our hearts and minds. It's not magic. It's not psychology. It's just Him bringing Himself to bear on our concerns in such a way it defies our human reasoning and our self-help strategies. It's beyond human comprehension. That's exactly what it says, isn't it? Which means you don't have to try and figure it out rationally. It's something He'll do. When we trust Him, His own peace will garrison the internal world for each one. Secondly, stay. That's the word to ponder. Stay there. Verse 8. Look at the things he tells us to dwell on. Dwell on these things. Dwell. Stay here. Stay your mind and your heart on the things that are true and honorable and right and pure and lovely, that has good repute, that's excellent, and anything worthy of praise. Now that is an amazing statement, because it'll cut through, if you're honest with me, it'll cut through about 72.5% of the rubbish that our minds are captured by. Because anything outside of these things will all be of the world. And guess what will surprise us is why we act like the world when we get anxious. It's because our minds are soaking all this up. So he's saying, don't dwell on that which is false. Don't do it. Don't dwell on that which is low, wrong, sleazy, disgusting, or despicable. Don't let your mind go there. Don't let it go there. Psalm 139, search me. Search me, O God. Know my heart. Try me. Know my anxious thoughts. You wonder why there's anxiety. See if there's any hurtful way in me. And lead me in the everlasting way. That's owning up to what's behind the anxieties. Desire for repentance, so to see him. See, God knows my thoughts. And of course, he knows everything about why I'm thinking what I'm thinking. You see, all true change happens in the thought life. All change happens there. Can't get around or over it. It's in it. Murder is traced to hate. Adultery is traced to lust. See, the truth be told, the real measure of maturity is not gifts and abilities. It's not financial success. It's not personal accomplishment. But really how a person thinks, that's the real measure of maturity. Isaiah 55 says, 7, let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord, he'll have compassion on him, and to our God, he'll have abundant pardon. See, that's the wonder of this, isn't it? All of those things that have caused anxiety, he said there's a sinfulness behind them. Well, certainly not trusting them. What he calls his way. Let him forsake his way, and so he'll bring forgiveness for each one of us. Is it any wonder then for us that time and thought, time and our thinking are so intimately connected? If our minds are not transformed by the truth of the scriptures, they are absolutely transformed by the thought patterns of the world. It's that simple. There's no big yawning gap in the middle. Time in the scriptures, being saturated in the truth, immersing ourselves in the word, over long periods of time, is the only way to force out the rubbish that clutters up the mind. But to let these things that he has just said, true and honorable and right and good, let these things shape attitude. Psalm 119:11, your word I have treasured. The word didn't become his 10-minute devotion every day. His word he treasured in his heart that he wouldn't sin against him. Lastly, say, stay, and obey. Look what he says in verse 9. Practice the things that you've learned and received and heard and seen in me, and the God of peace will be with you. Can you see those things? Now, one of the things that they have learned and heard, well, that's the gospel that he's been, all of the chapters prior to this verse is talking about. All anxiety is dispelled by when the Spirit of God applies the gospel of Jesus Christ. There isn't a plan B. There's no graduation process. It's the same message that saved you from all of our sin and worry and eternal damnation. It's the same message that deals with issues of disharmony in relationship and anxieties in the heart. Same message. It's a gospel of repentance. Gospel of peace. Paul was their teacher and their example. See, the first two things are about his instruction, yeah? You can't ever get away from just reading the stuff about doing. You've got to base it on what is it that I'm to believe that will just not just talk about the doing, but what is the rationale for it. But these parts are about the observations of Paul's life. He didn't just speak. So what he's saying here is, translate now your thoughts. Translate them into actions. And we will not only have the peace of God, but the God of peace. We've referred to the psalmist up till now, but you know why he was full of anxiety? Why he was? It's because of unconfessed sin. It's as simple as that. It just ate away at him. There's loads of psalms that really talk about what sin does, how it eats away at the internal world. But Paul says it to us. He says, talk to God. Say, pray. But don't just do that. Don't just rest there. That is not the whole message. It really isn't. And now it's to stay. Where are you going to place the things? What are we subjecting our minds to? Really is important, isn't it? And practice. You can't just pray and you can't just meditate and be like some monk in some monastery somewhere. Now it's to do these things. That's Paul's answer to anxiety. It's not just one, it's all three. So do we have any? Moms and dads, husbands and wives, fathers, mothers, children, workmates, do we have any strained relationships? Any at all? Did you have your 10 handbags of 10 paces this morning already? Well, they have to be reconciled, don't they? They have to be. You can't just go on the rest of the day and not be reconciled, because you know what happens? They fester more. And you'll be creative in your anxiety. You will. Strained relationships have to be reconciled. What was the greatest worries and concerns that you wrote about? Will you trust them? And will you trust them at his pace, not yours? In other words, if it doesn't change tomorrow, will you still trust him? Will you still walk with him in the midst of it if the circumstance doesn't change immediately? Are you tempted? Be honest with me now, all right? I'll be honest with you. Are you tempted to deal with your worries by the exercise of your remote control finger? Taking up more time in our lives as a distraction. I don't care about stuff, but when it becomes a replacement, well, then you've got to discipline that thumb severely. In their place, as Max Anders says again, pull up the weeds that you've allowed to grow in the garden of your mind. It's a great analogy, isn't it? Pull them up by the power of the Spirit of God. Lastly, you've got to realize this. You've got to agree with me about this morning. You've got to, by the Spirit of God, by the truth of his word, you've got to agree with me about this. Your contentment will not be found in anything else but Christ. You've got to agree with me about that. Because that's what Paul is saying here. That is what God is saying. The God of peace, bringing his peace to every anxiety. Let's bow and let's pray together. Amen. Our Heavenly Father, we have been blown away by your truth. We're still captured many times by our own fleshly commitment to be worried. It's like we have a right to be worried, and don't bother me. Father, we know that we can be stubborn, hard-hearted. We can not reject you. We won't cast you away. We'll just ignore you. We know, Lord, that you still hold our hand in the midst of our troubled minds. You won't let us go. You'll bring us through it even when we're rebelling. You never leave the room, ever. But I pray, Father, that for each concerned heart this morning, and my own, God, the myriads of things that can, when we can feel that we just can't even breathe, you tell us this morning to come to you. Lift our hearts and our eyes to you in the secret places where you are, where you reward. To fill our minds with the things that are good, noble and righteous and beautiful. Philip. And like Jesus, who rose from the dead, you call us to rise from inactivity and obey. And not just bring these words of concern to you, not just fill our minds with happy thoughts, but to get up and act. Do these things that your spirit is now saying to each one of us right now, this morning, in your presence. We submit ourselves to you and to your grace. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's come and close us in prayer, in a song.
One star burns in the darkness, shines with the promise, Emmanuel. One child born in the stillness, living within us, Emmanuel. We're singing glory. Glory, glory, let there
God in me. Let there be peace. Let it start in me.
I want you to bow your head just for a minute in our closing. I don't do big formal altar calls. I won't do that. It's not me. It's not what I'm about. Because I there's so many people who make that kind of profession on a weekly basis. There are times for it, of course, but that's not how I want to address us this morning. With your eyes closed, don't be looking around you. Do you have worries and concerns this morning? Just lift your hand up. Amen. Can you covenant with me right now before God that you will not allow that concern, that worry to define your heart? Will you covenant with that? Can you covenant to that with me right now? That you won't be mastered by those fears and worries is concerned. Will you covenant before God that they will not master you? Will you trust him this morning? Will you speak to him? Will you bring his word to bear? Will you receive his encouragement and instruction? Will you go to him in the secret place? Will you fill your mind and heart not with the things that bring a worldliness to us and therefore a doubt, but will you, by the power of the Holy Spirit, act on the things that he has put on your heart? Will you covenant with me this morning about that? So then, brethren, stand firm. Hold to the traditions which you were taught, whether by word of mouth or by letter from us. Now may our Lord Jesus Christ himself, God our Father, who has loved us and given us eternal comfort and good hope by grace, that he will comfort and strengthen your hearts in every good work and word. Amen. Let's love one another, brothers and sisters.
We're singing glory, glory.